God, we ask that you would speak in this moment. Lord, may we hear your voice, not my own. Open our hearts and minds to receive what you would say, and that may we respond in confidence and trust in you. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you, praise band. These youth don't even look tired. But speaking of youth camp, we know they were at youth camp all this past week, and I had the pleasure of going on Wednesday and spending some time with them. And I didn't know what to expect, but I really enjoyed the time with the youth, our leaders. I know I was tremendously blessed, and we're going to hear some more from. We'll see a video. We'll hear some testimonies here towards the end of the service, so you'll be looking forward to that. But when I got there, I'd heard about Doug Hill and his cooking expertise. And so I had some high expectations for lunch that day. I was in line. I saw Doug's apron. It said something like, if you don't like the cooking, just lower your standards, right? So I'm getting mixed messages. Like, I hear this is good, but why does his apron say that? But it was a great lunch. My expectations were not only met, but exceeded. Best chicken tacos I've had in all my life, Doug. So good job. And for all of this service, for him and our leaders, serving our youth. But so my expectations were exceeded. But the question that we have today was talking about expectations, and that's on the bulletin there on the front, is what happens to us when we have expectations and they're not met? What's our response? How do we act when that takes place? Because we all have expectations. It's kind of, we can't get away from that. We have expectations for tacos and for food. We go out to eat, or we buy some service. We hire someone. We have these expectations that for others. But we also have expectations for relationships. And so as we enter into this, and this is my second Sunday here, and when I want to just kind of get this out here to begin with just this idea of expectations that we have for one another. Because parents have expectations for their children. Our youth have expectations for their parents. We have expectations for our teachers, for our just different people in our lives, for our friends, for our spouses. I remember a while back reading about expectations in marriage, that there was this couple going through premarital counseling. And one of the homework exercises was for them to write down their expectations for their future husband and wife. And you might can imagine what that might have looked like. Because one of the spouses was shocked at the expectations that the other person had for them. Like, for example, if I grew up in a home and I saw things a certain way, and Susan, things were different for her, but I had on my list, I expect Susan to do the laundry, to do the dishes, to mow the yard, to take care of the kids, and I expect to just hang out, watch TV. I don't think, would those expectations go over? They would not. Sometimes we do have expectations, but the thing is about expectations is that often they're unspoken. They're there, they exist, but they're never shared. And then do you know when you find out what the expectations are? When you don't meet them. That's when we're very clear. But we have these expectations. And so I have expectations of you. And you, as a church, have expectations of me as your new pastor about how I'm going to be, what I'm going to say, how I'm going to function, and how things are going to happen here in Lavernia while I'm your pastor. We have these expectations. But we have these lists, but often they can be very unrealistic sometimes. Now, for example, here is an exaggerated description of the ideal pastor. And it's supposed to be funny, but there is some truth in this a little bit. But it says that the ideal pastor preaches 10 minutes, I'm already there. Dang it. I'm at 9 minutes. One more minute. The ideal pastor addresses sin, but never hurts anyone's feelings. He works from 8 a.m. until midnight and is also the church janitor. The ideal pastor makes $40 a week, wears great clothes, drives a nice car, buys great books, and donates 30 of the 40 to the church. He's 29 years old and has 40 years worth of experience. Has a great personality. He's married and has 2 to 3 perfectly behaved, cute children. So far, I'm okay, right? Except for the time. The ideal pastor has a burning desire to work with youth, but spends most of the time with the seniors. She smiles all the time with a straight face because she has a sense of humor that keeps her seriously dedicated to the church. She makes 15 home visits a day, but is always in the office when needed. The ideal pastor never misses any church meetings, but is always in the community evangelizing the unchurched. How are we doing so far? Do y'all feel it? You got it? We all have expectations, but unfortunately, there is no such thing as a perfect pastor. There's no such thing as a perfect church, except for Laverne United Methodist Church, of course. But there's no perfection in how we are together, even though we strive for that as we love one another. But sometimes our expectations really are too great. Sometimes no one. If this was the ideal pastor if this was y'all expectations, no one would ever make it. And any pastor would burn out and wouldn't be in ministry long trying to do all that. So we have to deal with expectations. Are they realistic or are they not? Now, we had a reading from Genesis. You may have wondered, what does this have to do with expectations? Now, last Sunday, we looked at Abraham. Well, he's still called Abram. It's in chapter 12, and he hears the call, and he listens, and he hears God's voice saying, go. And Abram listens, he hears, he even obeys. And as he obeys, he's trusting in God. And so, if we look in Hebrews, Abraham is lifted up as an ideal example of faith, a person of faith. Do y'all remember how this reading went earlier? This story falls right on the heels of what we just heard last Sunday. And here, very quickly, the unexpected is taking place in the land. He sees where the land's going to be given, but then there is this unexpected, this famine. Well, that's Abraham didn't know that was going to happen, and he has to flee. He goes down to Egypt, and here is Abram, this person of faith who's trusting in God, from the very beginning, starts to get afraid. He's afraid for his own life. And so do you feel hear the tension in this? You're going to be a great nation. I'm going to do this for you. I'm going to bless you, and you're going to bless others. But now there's this hardship going on. There's this famine. And now it seems like this person of faith isn't believing and trusting that much anymore. Abram's taking things into his own hands. And he lies. He lies about his wife. Sarah, can we talk for a second? Let's just say you're my sister. So they won't kill me. And then the Pharaoh takes Sarah into his own household. And the Pharaoh, after things turn out not so great for the Pharaoh, chews him out, saying, why did you lie? And I took your wife as my wife. And this is happening to us now. Get out of here. But here is Abram, a person of faith that I just wanted to highlight as an example. We would have great expectations for Abram. But very quickly, he doesn't meet them. And I tell you the story, and we share this morning, not as an example for us to follow in this part, right? Okay? But as an example that even the heroes of the faith were very human. They failed. they had great days, great weeks, but then they really messed up. And we do that too. And so I want just to take heart, take courage, that even Abraham struggled sometimes. And so do we. But as we begin our relationship together, this is the second Sunday with you, I just want us to acknowledge the struggle of expectations. Because in this room, we're probably about 65 of us here, and there are 65 lists of expectations. And I have no idea what's on your list. Some are short, some are long, and I'll tell you right now, I'm like Abram. I'm not going to meet all your expectations. As your pastor, but even the fruitfulness of our ministry, what we expect is going to happen because the new guy's in town, and he's young, and he has some kids. We're going to blow up with explosion with growth in people, okay? And I pray that that happens. But I just want us to just come to a realization of being humble and holding our expectations loosely with one another. So when I don't meet your expectations, I pray that you will, one, if you'll pray for me. And when you don't meet my expectations, I'm going to pray for you and thank God for you and be gracious to one another. Because, and this is what I want to really, and communicate, let's talk. If I'm not meeting expectation, I want to know. And maybe the expectations can be adjusted, and that it goes both ways. Because if we have two great high expectations, usually it's not the person that's not meeting them that changes. Like in marriage or relationships. Usually it's the person with the expectations that needs to make the adjustments. And will you do that with me as I do that with you? If you will, say sure. Or say we'll think about it. Or we'll pray about it. Yeah, that's better, praying about it. Because here's what I want to end with here. As we move towards the end here. Because even when our expectations are not met, and that's going to happen, even when our expectations are not met, that does not mean that God is not working. Okay? Even when our expectations are not met, that does not mean that God is not at work. For example, can we go back to tacos? Doug, is that all right? Let's say Doug's tacos were average. Maybe let's say on a scale of 1 to 10, let's say they were 3. Not very good at all. And I had these great expectations for Doug and the tacos. And then I eat them, and I'm like, bleh. But then I'm hungry, right? But I'm hungry. And I'm going to eat that whole taco because I'm hungry, right? In the midst of that, while the tacos weren't great, what blessings was there? Food. That's right. Nourishment. Protein. Some carbs. Some calories. That the food went into my belly, and my body received what it needed to keep functioning. Even in the midst of unmet expectations, there was the gift of food that nourishes our body. And so for us, even when our expectations for each other aren't met, what I want to encourage us to do is open our eyes and hearts to see the blessings even in the midst of the expectations that are not met. Because even when they're not met, God is still working. God is still gracious and loving and providing for us. And so keep your eyes open and look for the blessings that's present in the midst of the unmet expectations that is there. And this is the side note to this. Often our expectations, God surprises us with exes that we didn't have, but God works anyways. Like, for example, some of y'all know that we went to the San Antonio Missions baseball game this past Friday night. And, you know, there's a lot of foul balls that are hit into the stands in the midst of a game. We were sitting behind the first base dugout in that first close section, and one of the players hit a foul ball, and it goes way up into the sky. I mean, it's up there. And I noticed that it was kind of coming towards us. And I'm like, and Ellis is on my lap. He's playing a game. He'd watched some baseball, but now he was playing on his little tablet. And I'm like, that's coming towards us. But it's not going to come to us. So I get a drink of my drink, and I take a bite of my hot dog, and I look back up there, and I'm like, oh, it's still coming this way. Remember, it's way up there. I had time to do all that. And he's on my lap, and I'm like, that is coming pretty close. That's like coming right at us. But it's not going to hit us. It's not going to come. I'm just going to wait and see who it goes to. And it keeps coming, and it keeps coming, to where it's going to hit me in my face. So because I didn't believe it was coming, I didn't say, Ellis, go to your mother. Let me get my glove on and anticipate it. I was so late in responding to it. All I could do was duck. And the ball hits me on my back. Yeah, there's still a mark. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your sympathy. And then it hits me on my back, and then I feel behind me, and the ball's there. And I go like this. Got it. That's what I wanted to do in real life, was catch it with my hand, but it was too late. But I lift it up, I give it to Ellis or Meadow, and my chair caught the ball. I didn't, all right? The chair did. But here's the thing, that I did not believe it was going to come to us. It was coming right at us, and I saw the evidence of it. Nope, I did not expect it. And I was surprised. And I got the back scar to prove it. So even though, the point of that is that even though when our expectations are not met, there's still blessings in the midst of it all. But that doesn't mean that God isn't going to surprise us. God's free. God doesn't say, hey, what's y'all's expectations of me? I'm going to try to meet them. No. God gives us, and what is good to us, and giving us all that we need. And God is the free and sovereign to do what's best for us. God doesn't go according to our agenda. We live according to God's values and God's way. And so know this, that even if we don't think that God's going to do anything, get ready, because God sure might, and God will. I'm reading this story with first thing with my friend, Kevin, who's another pastor. And there's an interesting story. And I think it's chapter, I'm going to make up something, 9? Thank you. Something more. It's in that area. But Israel has rejected, like, God is king, and that we want a king. And the story begins with introducing Samuel, his father, and saying that the donkeys have gotten loose. And Saul's father goes, well, go look for the donkeys with one of the servant boys. And so they take off on this day journey trying to look for the donkeys, and they have no luck finding any of them. And then the little boy goes, and they're about to give up. Saul's like, let's go home. But the servant goes, no, there's this guy, Samuel, in another village. Let's go talk to him. He'll help us. And as they're going their way to visit Samuel, the scene changes. And it says that Samuel... I'll read it to you. It says that, now the day before Saul came, the Lord had revealed to Samuel, tomorrow about this time I will send you a man from the land of Benjamin, and you shall anoint him to be ruler over my people Israel. Saul's looking for donkeys. But what's God doing? God's sending him. Saul was going to be anointed king. And God was at work in the midst of the donkey search, and he didn't even realize it. God was at work, and he got surprised. And God does that for us, too. So let's have expectations for each other. Let's have expectations for God, but let's manage those. And sometimes God is going to exceed them. We think God isn't going to come through, but family of God, the Lord always comes through. For God is good. He, all the time, thank you. I keep going into that, I know. Because our hope, your hope isn't me, my hope isn't you. In life, our hope is Jesus, and He's faithful. He is good, and He will exceed our expectations as we seek and follow Him with our lives. Let's pray. Lord, as we respond to what we've heard this day, we worship You, and we thank You for Your faithfulness to us. Lord, help us to manage our expectations for one another. Help us to be gracious towards each other. Help us to help each other, to pray for another, and support one another as we keep our eyes on Your Son, Jesus, in the mission that You've called us to. Lord, we thank You that in the midst of our unmet expectations, You are good and You are at work. But Lord, we look forward to the surprises of Your goodness in surprising ways because You love us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And respond in some way. If you'd like me to pray with you, if you'd like to pray at the altar here at the kneelers, you're welcome to do so. I invite us to stand as we sing.